everybody, and welcome back to the Faith Brynels Insights podcast. I'm Faith Brynels, and today I'm joined by Dana. Hi, Dana. How are you today?
Hi, great to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Excellent, Dana. There's so much to unpack, Dana. Can you talk to us about yourself to the listeners first, please? Thank you. Great.
I'm a solicitor, and I qualified in one of the Magic Circle law firms. And after actually a career in journalism, that was my first kind of career. So I didn't come into law until much later. And I left and decided to start my own business. So I became an entrepreneur in 2010. Mm-hmm. I started a business called Obelisk Support. The idea was to return to the legal sector, but do law differently. In 2014, I also started a project called The First 100 Years, celebrating the centenary of women in law, which fell in 2019. So we did a lot of things linked to that. And I also now represent women solicitors on the Law Society Council.
Excellent, Dana. Thank you very much for sharing. And as I do that, because we've had some technical difficulties, my questions have disappeared. So I'm just copying them into the chat. So bear with me. So thank you, Dana, for sharing about your journey as well. It's really, really interesting because you are a TEDx speaker as well, which I read on your LinkedIn profile that you are an entrepreneur, that you are a solicitor. So there's so many questions really that I can really choose to unpack and talk to you about today. But the first thing I want to talk to you is about your business as well. So you mentioned that you started your business in 2010. What was the inspiration behind it?
So, to be honest, I wanted a business that was scalable, that wasn't just always depending on my skill. So obviously, as lawyers, we very often qualify into one area. I was an employment lawyer. And this is my second business. So in my first business, I explored the idea of being an entrepreneur. And I realized very quickly that if you are the expert in your business, that's a very limiting thing. And it's very difficult to build a bigger business if it all depends on you. So my challenge with my business was to create something bigger than myself. And the idea for it was to create flexible jobs for lawyers who were leaving very large law firms. And they were completely leaving the legal profession and practice. Obviously, my experience as a solicitor was in the city. So my clients that I understood were businesses. So I set up a business that was trying to provide flexible but quality legal support to businesses with the aid of what I called ex-city lawyers who wanted to work in a different way, to have more flexibility and be able to not compromise their career because they needed to look after children or older parents.
Excellent. That's really interesting, Dana, because I think that it's really important to know in terms of the legal sphere and in terms of the legal sector, people are very burnt out. People are overworked as well because the hours aren't flexible. So it's great that through your business as well, you're able to create an environment where they feel comfortable, where they feel that they can actually have children as well and kind of, you know, have a family, you know, have a family time and family life aside from the job. So thank you really for delving into just a few of the reasons why you started Obelisk Support as well in 2010. Now, I really want to delve into the first 100 years, which is really important because it's very important to me because I'm actually an aspiring barrister and as a black woman as well, it's great to see how the legal profession has developed and continues to develop. So again, really it's the same question as before, but can you explain your kind of the reason why that you created this business and also talk to us a little bit how you celebrated the kind of the landmark as well in I think it was in 2019 you mentioned.
Yeah, so to be honest, in my kind of relatively brief practicing career, I guess, in one of the big global law firms, I didn't necessarily feel I belonged because this is a story you hear from many people. I didn't really see a lot of women leaders. I didn't really see a path forward for me. And so in a way, when I left, I didn't think much about, you know, why are there not enough women and all those questions. But I think at the back of my mind, they existed. So in 2013, towards the end of the year, I read an article about another law firm and it was illustrated by a photograph that showed the partner celebrating 150 years of the law firm. And in the photograph, they had about 60 men all in black tie, and then one woman in the middle. And I thought, wow, it was 1982, and it was within my lifetime. And I thought, wow, I mean, they only had one woman. Maybe the answer is, you know, maybe there is something that we can discover in the history, why the progress is so slow. And so I asked myself, when did it all begin? And I realized, you know, when I, and I'm sure it's true of you and many of your, well, less of this generation because of us, but as I was going through all my legal education, I never came across any textbook, because I was on the business track, that had any judgments by women or any names of any lady justice, this and that, because they just weren't part of that kind of, you know, commercial world. If they were, they were mainly in the family law or maybe some criminal law aspects. And they, you know, they just never popped out of the books. We never had stories about women lawyers making an impact. And I realized that I had no education around the history of women in law, no knowledge about when women were allowed to be lawyers. And I remember I asked my friends, you know, because once I found out the law had to change to allow women in, I asked my friends, you know, when do you think women were allowed to come in? And they were like, oh, 1950, 1800. Everybody had a different answer, but nobody knew. Nobody knew that women couldn't be qualifying before 1919. And that required a change of law to make it possible. And I thought, wow, we don't know anything about our past. And could this be an answer to our kind of feeling that we don't belong to the legal profession, because we don't really know we're part of a history. We just think we are this, you know, in some kind of suspended animation. So that made me realize that if we didn't celebrate 100 years really in kind of in a big way, we will waste an opportunity to really tell the story and really, if you like, empower the next generation with all those the information of the past that we didn't have. So really, that's what made me start it. I mean, I had a very young family. So my daughter, at the point we started, I think she was 3 years old. So there was a lot of stuff going on in my life and the business and a young family. But I just thought, if I don't start now, it will pass unnoticed. Yeah. Or maybe a couple of people will do something. But what if we dream bigger? What if we do something much, much bigger? Because there's so many women around who are lawyers. And basically, that's how I just expanded the idea into what I always call a kind of festival dedicated to women in law, where we had lots of parties by the end of the, you know, 2019. We had an exhibition, we had artwork, we had music, we had it all, basically. And that was the idea, to make it a big celebration and really make sure that the history is known and is carried forward.
Excellent, Dana. I can really feel the passion as well. You know, I can really feel the passion, albeit virtually, but I can feel the passion when you're talking about women's achievements, really, and celebrating what they have done. And as you mentioned, you made a good point as well. If you didn't do it, who would do it? And, you know, because that's why it's really important to celebrate what they have done and to continue to raise awareness at the same time as well. So thank you again for delving into it passionately, giving us a great insight, because it is called Faith Brynels Insights. So, you know, my listeners are here for an insight, which you have undoubtedly provided. So thank you very much as well for delving into that. Now, this is a question that you haven't had, but I was looking into your kind of background as well, how you went to, you know, talking about your university life as well. So I kind of wanted to kind of garner some tips from you for aspiring legal professionals who are currently, let's say, in university now, and they want to get work experience. What is the best way for them to stand out in their applications?
I mean, I'm an entrepreneur, so I never follow fashion. So my advice will never be do what everybody does, because I don't think that's a good way to stand out. Obviously, do a podcast. I think it's a very good way to do something different, but and meet people, which is a very good thing to do in the legal profession. Get out, be curious, ask for help, because you'll be amazed how many people are open to having a 20-30 minute conversation. Obviously, you can have all the legal experience, and I'm sure people say, you know, go to a law center, volunteer time. But I think if you think you want to be, for example, a city lawyer, let's say, then think about what their clients want. Who are their clients? It's always sometimes more beneficial to be out and about understanding the business than necessarily just thinking about you as a lawyer in the business. Because by seeing the real world, if you like, is how you learn how law affects it. And so for me, if you want to be a city lawyer like I ended up being, if you're interested in business, which you have to be because that's the nature of their work, apply to work in industry, go and join a vacation scheme at one of the banks or one of the other multinational organizations who might be their client, because then you come with a fresh perspective about how these transactions, how do these bits of work fit into the legal practice. So to me, I think outside the box and not be afraid that if you haven't done all the work experience and all of those things. I've done no work experience before I got my training contract in the legal space. I just applied because I was interested in the type of business, in the type of client, and I wanted to be close to that business. And, I was curious and enthusiastic, and that's what got me there. It wasn't just about ticking every single box and thinking there's no other way. I think there are ways if you think slightly broader.
Excellent, Donna. That's really interesting as well. One second, my mic has just dropped. Yes, excellent. Thank you. Thank you very much for sharing again about your perspective as well, looking at training contracts. You know, it's really important to stand out. You know, it's really important to be different as well and try and do something that really should, you know, that really indicates and shows your passion and your drive to be in that particular career path as well. So thank you very much, Donna, for speaking from a point of experience because you are an entrepreneur, TED speaker, and a solicitor as well, and many more. There's so much, Donna, that we could unpack today, but I'm weary of time. So I also want to talk to you a little bit about being a TEDx speaker. So can you talk to us about how that happened and talk to us maybe about your favorite talk so far?
So, look, to be honest, doing a TEDx talk is really special. It's a very specific type of talk. It takes quite a few months of preparation. I think the main thing is obviously it's what they say. You know, they want ideas that are worth spreading. So they need to be quite universal ideas. But obviously they are grounded in your personal life. So in my case, I think the subject that caught my attention was discovery. And because I was involved in this kind of backward discovery with the first 100 years, I basically talked about the gift of the past and that journey of discovering and how we take it for granted. And in my case, the TEDx came quite soon after my father passed away. And I realized that part of that kind of recovery of memory, you know, holding on to your family and all the things that you had really close to you, is that you go for all these kind of, you know, photographs and family memories and all of that. And I realized because of my upbringing and I grew up under communism, I didn't really have a lot of evidence of my childhood. I didn't have photographs with my parents. And it was a real surprise to me because I never stopped to think how I cataloged my life. I just went along with day by day, you know, and only once he passed away, I realized I actually do not have any photographs with both my parents in them as a small child. And what a kind of loss to me, you know. So I had this kind of sense of loss going back in time, which was very similar to what I felt when I started the first 100 years. And I heard of all these pioneering woman names, but I couldn't put a face to the name because nobody had a photograph. Nobody knew who they were. There were no obituaries. There was no trace of them. And that made me very sad. And I thought, wow, we've got to change this, you know, because history is written based on this documentation. You need the evidence to write the story. And if we don't have the evidence, we'll never have the story. And so that's kind of, you know, exactly. Like that was my idea worth spreading, is to make sure that we record our histories in a more proactive way, especially as women, and make sure that whatever we leave, because, you know, as somebody said, you know, our past and our present is their future and your future. So we owe it to you that we leave some kind of record and
legacy.
They couldn't for us, you know, in the past. And to some degree, I realized through my childhood, I also couldn't as much as I would like to, but it's really incumbent on us to do more to make sure those stories can be written in the future with more ease. So that's how I ended up doing the TEDx.
Excellent,
about
yeah.
something that I'm passionate about, as you can see.
Yes, again, I can really feel and hear the passion. I can really feel and hear the enthusiasm as well. You really are a ray of light to this podcast today. So thank you, Dana, as well, for sharing your wonderful story. And really, you know, that really is an important point. We have to leave a legacy for our children and our children's children as well, and really to change the narrative. As you mentioned, there are so many pioneering, you know, women as well, but unfortunately their faces were not known because because back then they weren't seen as pioneering. But now when we actually, you know, when we actually kind of reflect and look back at their journey and look back at their lives, we really understand the impact, you know, the extent of the impact really that they have made and continue to make in our society. So thank you, Dana, really, for persevering through technical difficulties that we actually had off camera today with our new platform. But thank you very much for pushing through as well. And just finally, I think you have two honorary doctorates as well. Can you talk to me about that story and how that happened?
Well, they were pretty magical moments, really, because before I became a lawyer, in fact, I was going to do a PhD in history. And and then I changed course suddenly, and I said, well, actually, I can always do a PhD later, further down the line. Now maybe I need to get a profession to earn some money after a few years at university. And so it was something that recognized, I mean, both of them were incredibly special. I collaborated with these universities. They're not my universities. So one is University of Worcester, the other one is the University of Glasgow. And it was through my work and championing history, championing students, being involved in our project. And if you like, in the case of the University of Glasgow, they created, if you like, their own women history project, which they carried on, inspired by the first 100 years. So it was basically opening this kind of wider space through students, through the staff, to really continue the work we started. Really special moments, actually, and both of them really, they're definitely part of my memory box.
Excellent, Dana, and congratulations as well for both of those. I know that that they were well deserved as well, especially hearing about your work as well. So, you know, hearing about your really inspiring journey and the work that you continue to do to inspire many women. So thank you very much, Dana, for gracing your presence with us today on the Faith Brynels Insights podcast. And just my final question, because this interests me, what was the motivator for you to specialise in employment law as opposed to like contract law or something like that?
People is the quick question, quick answer. And because I spent 3 months on a secondment with a free representation unit, I definitely recommend volunteering there if you want to be, especially if you want to go to the bar. But anyway, it's a great place to start doing some advocacy. I realized by being a volunteer sent by my law firm how important it was to have legal representation, and how having somebody argue in a coherent way for you can really change outcomes. And also I realized, because all of the cases were employment law, how emotionally straining it was for people to be caught up in this kind of dispute at work. Work is so important to all of us. And it was so important to kind of be able to give the comfort, fight their corner, and remember the person in the case, you know, where sometimes when you're in a bigger corporate, you very often forget. And I think to me that really brought it very close to me. It did make me afraid of hiring anyone for a while, to be honest, when I started my business, because I thought, wow, it's so complicated to manage people. But you get over that, I think. But it's I've always carried it with me. How do you lead, and how do you think of the person in your business? You have to take business decisions, but always remember the human. And and I think employment from that point of view was very close to what I love, which is people.
Excellent, Dana. And that's the true essence of leadership as well. Being a true leader is being able actually to support people in their times of need and to build people up as well. So thank you, Dana, again for sharing that, and also for emphasizing the importance of being a volunteer and volunteering as well in terms of kind of moving into your ideal career. So my actual last question is, how can the listeners contact you after the show's over today?
I'm most active on LinkedIn, so they can connect with me and ask for connections and questions. I'm also on Instagram, not as often, but I am, so I'm not sure where they are. I'm absolutely not on TikTok, so you will not find me there, but you might find a fake of me there, so hopefully not. But in terms of social media platforms, LinkedIn or Instagram are probably my kind of two places. And just DM me, and if I can help and guide in any way, I'll be happy to.
Excellent, Dana. So I will put a link of your LinkedIn as well for you. So thank you very much, Dana. And thank you to all of my listeners for tuning in to the Faith Brynels Insights podcast today. I'm Faith Brynels, and today we've had the lovely Dana on our show to talk about her wonderful and inspirational journey. So thanks again, everybody. And without further ado, this is your host, Faith Brynels. I'm signing off. Bye, everybody, and have a great week. Thanks again.